Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Journey into Knicks. Marshall Sutcliffe in the booth with Zach Hill. We're in the second quarterfinal match here. A best two out of three. Patrick Chapin up against Jamie Parke. Now, this is two old school vets of Magic. These players have top eighted Pro Tours in three different decades now.
Yeah, it's crazy you're seeing a top eight match between both or two players for whom that's true.
Patrick Chapin is a Hall of Famer for the Pro Tour. And it looks like we can see why. There will be no die roll to decide who goes first here in the top eight. That, of course, is decided by your ranking coming in and your seed and Patrick Chapin.
Could I possibly get a note
first seed? He's going to start off with Temple of Plenty. Now, talk to us real quickly here, Zach, about the matchup that we're seeing here, Junk Midrange versus Bug Control.
Well, in many ways, Patrick's deck designed to prey upon some of the other midrange decks by just presenting resilient threat after resilient threat. On the other hand, I'm looking at Jamie's deck right now. First of all, the Bug deck was designed, in Josh Adder Layton's words, basically have no bad matchups. I don't know how well that's considered Patrick's deck. Patrick's has beaten up on a lot of Bug decks over the course of Friday and Saturday. But in general, I think we're going to see a very interactive, good match. I don't think it's going to be a blowout match. Looking at Jamie's hand, he has two lands, Sylvan Caryatid and Read the Bones, which is about what you want in this matchup. He's got a pair of Heroes Downfalls for whatever threats Chapin may play. Bile Blight, one of the few cards that can kill Fleece Mane Lions. So I think it's a pretty reasonable hand for Jamie. I think we're going to see a good game of Magic.
All right, Jamie Park's going to kick things off here with a card that we're going to see a lot of in the feature match area as we move forward into the weekend. Sylvan Caryatid, and it looks like Jamie's hand is all black.
Yeah, Bile Blight, Drown in Sorrow, Double Heroes Downfall, Read the Bones. Temple of Mystery means he's going to be able to cast that Read the Bones if he wants to, and just a lot faster start from Jamie. On the other end, not really accelerating into anything. No Kiora, for example, to be able to take advantage of that acceleration. Patrick, bunch of answers as well. Downfall, Banishing Light, Elspeth, basically just waiting around to cast Elspeth, Sun's Champion.
All right, so here is Read the Bones. One of the only ways that Jamie Parke has to draw cards in the traditional sense of just taking them from your library, putting them in your hand. He has a lot of ways to get card advantage, mainly through Courser of Kruphix. But this is one of the few ways he has just to reload. He's going to scry two, then he's going to draw two cards. He's also going to lose two life as a result here. But in a matchup like this, Patrick Chapin does not have his turn two Fleece Mane Lion. So we've got pretty much the coast clear here for Read the Bones to resolve.
And Jamie can just keep leveraging those temples. I mean, Jamie very, very able to control his draws right here.
All right, he's going to put a forest on the bottom, pass a turn back. No plays yet for Patrick Chapin, but I have a feeling we're going to see something here. Nothing. Double mana confluence. He's got all of his mana. Doesn't want to commit anything to the board. He's got Elspeth in hand along with Double Heroes Downfall, Banishing Light. So he really has nothing to play here.
Yeah, you might be asking why he's playing out those mana confluences when he has two forests in his hand, not going to have to take as much damage, but he wants to be able to represent double black for Hero's Downfall at the end of the turn.
Not just represent it, he wants to be able to cast it. Yeah.
Right.
And Jamie's going to have none of it, as both players have mainly reactive spells in hand, and they're just going to be playing the land go game here. Again, you mentioned Jamie Park sculpting his draws thanks to all of the scry lands and scry from his Read the Bones here. Is he really going to be able to find something nice? Here's another one, though. Again, no threats currently for either player.
Right, so, I mean, no player is in danger of this game ending anytime soon. We see answers and answers, downfalls, drowns in sorrow, even Elspeth.
And Elspeth. Here comes Elspeth, Sun's Champion for Patrick Chapin. He's going to take a couple of damage, but well worth it in this case, as Elspeth is going to start making tokens and things are going to get out of hand quickly if Jamie Park doesn't have an answer, which he does.
Yeah, right, exactly. We know Jamie is able to deal with this. One of the things Patrick knows, though, is Jamie Park, even though he's playing a control deck, his counter magic suite is a grand total of one dissolve. So just by virtue of Elspeth resolving, yeah, it's going to get Heroes Downfall, but in order to do something about those tokens, Jamie's going to either have to spend a Drown in Sorrow or a Bile Blight. Patrick knows his Elspeth is going to be worth at least two cards. And if Jamie lets the token sit on the table, they're going to be able to threaten any planeswalker, specifically Kiora, that he's able to play.
Yeah, and I think Jamie drew a Courser of Kruphix for his turn, though, potentially. Yeah, that is what it was. And that's going to do a nice job of holding these tokens at bay. He's got a Sylvan Carry added as well that can block. And basically, he's going to make sure that those tokens don't get too much work done. I don't think he really feels the need to fire off that BioBite at this stage.
Yeah, I mean, one of the plays you just saw is actually one of the defining plays of the tournament. That's yes. Courser, Temple off the top of your deck, Scry another land at the bottom. That means that your 2/4 basically drew you two cards and is threatening to draw you more cards every turn of the game.
And yeah, he also happened to reveal Kiora the Crashing Wave as well, so not too bad for Jamie Parke. As you see, that play that you just mentioned, Zach, it just whittles right through the library and gets right to the good stuff.
And now Jamie trying to decide if he wants to do anything or worry about those tokens. You know, has access to 2 black mana if he taps his Sylvan Caryatid. Right now he can represent Dissipate mana, although or Dissolve mana, although Patrick nearly 100% sure he doesn't have it. Patrick has a lot of options next turn. He can either play another Elspeth or play a Downfall into Courser of Kruphix.
Heard Chapin say we can't all be so
lucky. If I'm Patrick, I mean, I think I want to get the Courser off the table because with Kiora, I mean, between the draws from that and the new card on top of the library, really likely that Jamie's going to be able to see yet another land on top of his deck. And getting your own Courser on the battlefield, pretty important right now to be able to keep up with some of that card advantage.
So there's one hero's Downfall that's going to be used to take down the Courser of Kruphix, but that's interesting from Jamie Park's side is, do you assume Chapin has another one? Chapin knows that Kiora is on the way.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. I think the fact that you know that your opponent knows the same information that you do can be extremely relevant when you see a decision like that. You can't assume that Patrick's just using an answer to your Courser with just no way to threaten Kiora.
All right, nice follow-up here for Patrick Chapin, his own Courser of Kruphix.
17-17.
And a land evens things up at 17 apiece.
And Patrick relevantly missing, quote-unquote, on his Courser of Kruphix. And as we saw with Josh Utter-Layton's game one, whether or not a land is on top of your deck when Courser is on the battlefield can sometimes dictate the flow of the entire game. Now, Fleece Mane Lion on the top of Chapin's deck. That card relevantly dodges basically every removal spell and attacks through Courser of Kruphix, and in a pinch can block basically all the creatures from the popular red-green Elspeth deck that we've seen all weekend.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, too, because Chapin has enough mana now that he can actually play Fleece Mane Lion and Monstrous in the same turn if needed. Yeah,
basically a 7-mana, 4/4 indestructible hexproof, not the worst rate on a creature.
But we're back over to Jamie Parke here. We saw that he drew Kiora. Chapin saw that he drew Kiora.
And Jamie has to make sure to tap his lands, right? He wants to make sure he can leave open Bile Blight for those tokens and protect the Kiora if he has to. Tapping Sylvan Caryatid means he doesn't have a blocker for a Courser of Kruphix. Might see a Silence the Believers on that Courser. A lot of options for Jamie right now. Chapin also by no means out of gas. Yet another Elspeth follow-up could be pretty big if Jamie ends up using any of those mass removal spells. Jamie can also choose right now to say, okay, I'm going to go ahead and draw a card with Kiora, and okay, good for you if you threaten it.
We've seen that pretty often, too, that Kiora will just go into draw card mode. I think the assumption being that, well, if she's going to get removed, I get a 2-for-1 out of the deal.
Yeah, right, exactly. I mean, you get another land drop, too. Land's really important in a matchup like this where you're basically full of cards essentially every turn. And there's a combination, of course, of Kiora and Courser of Kruphix. But Jamie's Courser, of course, bit the dust last turn.
All right, so Kiora draws Jamie Parker card, also gives him another land drop.
And he drew Courser this turn, so with another land on top, he could draw an additional card from Courser, conceivably. It looks like if he's playing a land from his hand, probably not going to play the courser. Unless he hasn't played a land already and still has an additional land drop.
Still holding on to that Bioblight. He's had that since his opener here.
And that looks like exactly what we're going to see. And he set up the scry, but
this is drowning. Sorry.
Oh, okay. Getting yet another scry. So, I mean, you see the ability of the black-blue-green deck to really control the quality of its draws.
There we go. That's how you want to do it, Jamie. That way he can leave up his Sylvan Caryatid to block the Courser and potentially keep Kiora alive or at least force Patrick Chapin to do something about it.
Yeah, that's a huge difference, being able to keep that Sylvan Caryatid on tap and Jamie really taking advantage of the extra land drop offered to him by Kiora.
Fleece Mane Lion hits the hand for Chapin. He sees Temple of Malady on top. And there's Silence the Believers now on top of Chapin's library, though he gets to decide if he wants to scry that to the top or bottom. He's going to bottom it. Uninterested, as there's no great targets for it, and he finds Pelucranos.
Pelucranos, pretty big game, especially when one of your opponent's removal spells is a Bioblight. Not going to even come close to killing Pelucranos. Basically forcing Park to use Hero's Downfall or Silence the Believers or risk the game ending in very short order.
All right, so Chapin has Elspeth in his hand. But it looks like he wants to cast the Fleece Mane Lion here. Well, he keeps faking me out a little bit. Nope, it is Fleece Mane Lion.
I take two. 16.
And I think he's going to Monstrous it immediately. Yeah, he is. So he wants to take this turn to get that Fleece Mane Lion into battle mode, but while Jamie Park is tapped out.
Yeah, and he wants to do it immediately so that, for example, Jamie can't activate the plus one of Kiora targeting it, and then if Patrick tried to respond, he'd be able to hit it with Bile Blight, or independent of any of those things, Jamie could just, you know, Bile Blight, respond with Hero's Downfall, respond with Silence the Believers. Basically, if Chapin does it on his main phase, Jamie has absolutely no options for what to do with that Fleece Mane Lion.
As it stands, that's a nice play because Jamie has quite a few options for killing an unmonstrous Fleece Mane Lion in his hand. Not going to get to use them, though. Here is Courser of Crucifix, of course, for Jamie Park. He's going to play Man Confluence off 18, of it, jump 16. Up to 18 life, and maybe even reveal, well, another Courser of Crucifix.
Pretty unbelievable, the combination of Kiora and Courser of Crucifix. That is a lot of cards and a lot of mana very fast.
It really is.
That said, I mean, card advantage is important, but there's no Sphinx's Revelation, no Cruel Ultimatum in these decks. However many cards the bug deck draws, it doesn't have that many good ways to answer Fleece Mane Lion. You basically have to block with a Prognostic Sphinx and hope that your opponent can't do anything to either increase the size of the Fleece Mane Lion, threaten your Prognostic Sphinx to tap it before it gets in for damage. I mean, you know, obviously card advantage is good here, just like it's good everywhere else, but we're used to seeing a lot of control decks with these big, kind of impossible-to-stop late games. That is not what the black-blue-green control deck really does.
Right, it's the grindiest of grindy, and Jamie Park is going to cash in Kiora to draw that Courser. He reveals Read the Bones, doesn't play the Courser, even though he has 7 mana available, and passes the turn back to Patrick Chapin here. So this is an interesting one, as Chapin really has to do a lot of thinking about what kind of cards Jamie Park can have in his hand. He knows he drew the Courser and just didn't play it.
Yeah, Park leaving open mana for Bioblight, Hero's Downfall, and double Silence the Believers, basically threatening whatever Chapin casts next. Jamie knows about Pelucranos, World Eater. Chapin can't really assume that Pelucranos is long for this world, but Park representing both Silence the Believers and Hero's Downfall, forcing Patrick to lean primarily on Fleece Mane Lion for the bulk of his offense.
Yeah, it starts off the offense by attacking and gets in there. And it's going to drop Jamie Park down to 14, and here's Elspeth for Patrick Chapin.
Interestingly, Patrick not prioritizing removing Courser of Crucifix from the board. Jamie has been able to leverage Courser really strongly, and with Read the Bones on top of his deck, you have to assume that Jamie's going to be able to set up a land on top of his library if he wants to.
This could be a big one here for Jamie Parke. He's got multiple removal spells in hand.
Patrick letting Jamie know that he's got some believers on his side of the board if Jamie wants to spend those on tokens.
All right, Hero's Downfall is going to take care of Elspeth, Sun's Champion, and Jamie's just going to take his turn here. Draws the Reed the Bones, reveals a swamp, plays the swamp off of his Courser of Crucifix, gains another life. Is this getting familiar?
I think we've seen a little bit of this. Yeah, and Patrick knows that he can essentially throw away Elspeth to the Hero's Downfall because he's got yet another Elspeth on top of his deck, and Jamie's only going to have so many Hero's Downfalls. Now, he also has Bile Blight in his hand, meaning that whenever he wants to, he can get rid of essentially an infinite number or any sane number of Elspeth tokens. The question is just how much pressure will Patrick be able to mount with that offense? I mean, he can remove Courser of Crucifix if it turns out he wants to.
All right, so Jamie Parke casts Read the Bones. He's in the scry portion of the Read the Bones operations here. One of them was a swamp. You got to figure he's had about enough of those.
Yeah, I think Jamie basically just digging the Prognostic Sphinx here. Yeah, wow. Wow.
He has to show them because they're revealed on top by the Courser.
And those were basically the two perfect draws for Jamie Parke. Dissolve just incredible in this matchup. Answers Elspeth without Elspeth being able to make tokens. Also one of the few answers to Fleece Mane Lion. Prognostic Sphinx answers Fleece Mane Lion, starts to scry and forms an offense for Jamie. Jamie scrying away essentially two blanks to draw maybe the best two cards in his deck that he could possibly get off that Read the Bones.
He even has the mana to cast both of them this turn as well. Prognostic Sphinx hits the battlefield. He's left up three mana so that he can dissolve anything really egregious from Patrick Chapin's side of the board. Remember, Elspeth on top of his library, that's a card that Jamie Parke does not want to see from his opponent.
Yeah, and really, this game has been about Courser of Crucifix from Jamie's side. I mean, Courser drawn several extra cards, and it's what allows Jamie to find the Read the Bones, which finds the Prognostic Sphinx. Patrick has had removal for the Courser. He's just opted to play more threats.
He pushes the land to the bottom and sees another one on top of his library.
I mean, Patrick relevantly can start using Banishing Light and Hero's Downfall to essentially just tap Prognostic Sphinx for a turn, allowing his Fleece Mane Lion plus his tokens to get in for damage. I think it might be a bit premature to do that right now, but you cannot allow Jamie to take over this game with more scrawls and an untap. I mean, you see he's got Bile Blight double silence the believers. Now I think is the time to try and leverage your tokens if they're going to do anything at all. Even if he is only able to tap the Sphinx, making Jamie discard a card is relevant with all the cards in Jamie's hand being as high quality as they currently are.
All right. In comes the team. Everybody attacking.
See the Banishing Light eating the Courser of Crucifix, meaning that one more of Jamie's tokens can get, or one more of Patrick's tokens can get through. Jamie going to have to cast another Courser of Crucifix if he wants to start playing lands off the top of his deck. And you have to expect Jamie blocking Fleece Mane Lion here. Only going to take three damage. Not worth taking three extra damage, I think, to eat one of those tokens, especially since you're sitting on Bile Blight in your hand.
So Jamie does block as such. Speaking of Bile Blight, looks like Jamie doesn't want to take the damage. He's not worried about anything that Patrick can cast this turn, apparently, as this is going to leave Dissolve mana tapped down. Also, Chapin knows about the Dissolve anyway, right? So it's lessened. Jamie does know that Chapin has Polukranos in his hand.
And he also knows about Elspeth, although Patrick one mana short of being able to cast Elspeth.
He is.
Your turn.
Interestingly,
Chapin's
not
just
going to
pass the turn back there.
Downfall the Sphinx.
Okay.
And here's downfall.
And that means that he's spinning. I think Patrick basically knows Jamie's hand because of the Courser of Krufix, so he knows that this hero's downfall is going to bait a live spell. I mean, Jamie doesn't want to lose Courser, Dissolve, Silence, or Silence. If Patrick cast Polukronos, that would open up his Courser and Polukronos to a single Silence the Believers. So I think Patrick wants to run Jamie out of those cards as much as possible while tapping down the Sphinx to be able to pressure Jamie's life total.
I mean, it is a one-for-one here, right?
Right, exactly. And it also prevents Jamie from scrying for three with the Sphinx if he did want to opt into attacking. We see it get the Silence the Believers.
One of them. Another one still in hand for Jamie. Park draws his card for the turn.
I mean, Jamie, the second Courser, hugely relevant here, is it's going to allow Jamie to continue looking at the top of his deck, continue to get rid of excess lands, and provides another blocker to deal with Patrick's own Courser.
Wow, Prognostic Sphinx on the top here for Jamie Park as well.
And that dissolve from Park means that Elspeth, which is normally obviously one of the biggest threats in this matchup, just not going to accomplish a lot right now.
Park also has an extra forest in his hand here that he's decided not to play so that he can have it for later for his Prognostic Sphinx.
Yeah, that forest is big because both Silence of the Believers right now, very, very important, both to threaten Courser of Krufix and Polukronos. Park's Dissolve, meanwhile, dealing with Patrick's Elspeth, and the Courser of Krufix, meaning that Park will eventually have access to extra cards. So, I mean, Patrick's still able to deal some damage right now with that Fleecemane Lion, but Patrick really wanted to be able to either draw into something big or hit another land to be able to play it off the Courser. And again, all the extra creatures that Patrick drawing basically mitigated by that Silence the Believers that he knows is in Jamie's hand.
Is Chapin running Thoughtseize?
Chapin is running three copies of Thoughtseize, really one of the best cards he could possibly draw right now.
Yep.
I think Jamie trying to decide whether he wants to attack with Sphinx, maybe? Is it Patrick's main phase still?
Three cards.
Yeah. I mean, given that Patrick knows about Brimaz on top of his deck, he could run Polukronos out there, basically baiting the Silence the Believers right away and clearing the way for Brimaz, but opting into your opponent's two-for-one is always a risky proposition.
All right, there's Polukronos for Patrick Chapin. And Jamie Park seems happy to let that happen. Are we going to see a big Silence of Believers here?
I think we have to assume that's what's going to take place.
He's got the mana to hit two different things. He can hit the Courser and Polukronos. Chapin, of course, knows what's coming. In fact, the cards are already gone by the time Jamie goes to target them. And Jamie's got to be happy with that. Another way to get far ahead in this matchup is just to continually two-for-one your opponent. And those were two really important cards that Jamie just hit.
Yeah, I mean, I think maybe what Patrick is trying to do is just make sure Jamie doesn't have that many raw cards in his hand. I mean, he knows that Brimaz is on top. Brimaz still revealed, but Courser of Krufix not on the battlefield.
Yeah, we'll get that turn back over.
I'm trying to understand that play. If Patrick had one more mana, he could cast Elspeth through Dissolve and at least force Jamie to use Silence of the Believers on his own turn. But, I mean, yeah, just a big play for Jamie.
All right, speaking of big plays for Jamie, he's attacking. 5 damage hitting the red zone, and of course a scry 3 from Prognostic Sphinx.
I am assuming that Patrick knows all of the cards in Jamie's hand because Courser's been out for a while, but that Silence of the Believers I think might actually have been in Jamie's hand from the opening turn, so Patrick may not have known 100% about the Silence of the Believers.
Does know about the Dissolve, and he knows about the Prognostic Sphinx.
I'm at 12.
And that's going to knock Patrick Chapin down to 12 life.
After he plays this land.
Yet another essentially drawn card there by the courser, and it's going to reveal a hero's downfall incoming from Jamie Parke. And a pair of prognostic sphinxes are now poised for battle against Patrick Chapin. No, only one card in his hand. He's got Brimaz, King of Oresco, sitting on top of his library for his draw step. But unfortunately for him, those prognostic sphinxes are doing a nice job of keeping the Fleece Mane line that's been monstrosity to bay. Elspeth, Sun's Champion, is going to force dissolve here from Jamie Parke. Patrick Chapin knew that that was there, and this is going to clear the way for him to play Brimaz. Though Brimaz is starting to get outclassed pretty quickly here, as those sphinxes are going to kill Patrick Chapin in two turns in the air. And while they do it, they're going to set up Jamie Parke with some nice draw steps.
Yeah, exactly. And Patrick knows that Jamie's got the hero's downfalls and knows that Brimaz is not long for this world. Doesn't even play Brimaz, I think, because he doesn't want to tap a mana confluence, potentially. Either way, things looking pretty bad for Patrick right here.
Tech, tech, scry twice.
Yep.
Jamie obviously not really excited about that Drown in Sorrow. Probably going to ship it to the bottom, give himself access to three more cards off the second scry trigger.
He ended up actually shipping all three to the bottom there.
Yep. Scry.
Second scry three trigger is resolving here. He's going to go through six cards off the top of his library.
Three on the bottom.
See Patrick smiling there. He's like, hey, okay, you're going to go through these motions, but I'm way far behind. Kind of just waiting for his next turn to see if he can put something together.
Could not see what Jamie did there.
Six to ten. Milady on top. Go to six to ten.
BDM smile somewhere.
Yeah, of course. The lame puns being a fixture of magic culture across the globe.
Temple of Malady hits the battlefield, and yet another scry here. It's another temple, this time of deceit. But these aren't nearly the most important thing on this battlefield. It's two times prognostic sphinx with nothing on Patrick Chapin's side.
So many believers continuously. Nonstop.
Draw step for Chapin. Picks up his hand. Has not conceded.
Patrick referencing Silence the Believers. I think he drew one of them out early. I think he just didn't expect the second. Didn't know about the second. I mean, that was the pivotal moment of the game.
Very few believers talking. When Jamie Parke is on the other side of the battlefield here, Fleece Mane Lion is going to enter the red zone. Desperation attack here, Zach. Is this just Chapin going through the motions and having Jamie Parke finish him off? Jamie Parke did block here with Sylvan Carry added.
Yeah, I mean, Patrick could theoretically live another turn if he's able to cast a removal spell on one of those prognostic sphinxes. Tapping it down, that means that Jamie can only attack for five. So, you know, the attack is meaningful. It's either forcing Jamie to block with Sylvan Caryatid or to take four damage, which puts him within striking range if Patrick's able to chain together numerous removal spells. You see, Patrick has Silence the Believers in hand, so he can tap down both those sphinxes and make Jamie discard two cards. It's actually going to be a big moment on Jamie's upkeep.
Your turn.
All right, so Chapin scrapping and fighting, trying to stay alive here.
And we actually see Chapin's not taking a damage to cast Brimaz last turn, allowing him to survive an attack potentially from just a Sphinx and a Courser.
Yeah, he needs seven mana to be able to effectively tap down both Sphinxes. Did he wait till Jamie Parke's draw step? No.
I don't think so.
This is upkeep. He knows his draw. He wants to make sure that he hits the highest chance of hitting a spell here. He can make Jamie, effectively force Jamie to discard both of his cards in hand and get him down to nothing but a drawn Temple of Deceit for the turn.
And now with taking two for Mana Confluence, going to four, but he's still able to safely take a hit from Courser of Krufix.
This is good and close.
Yes, I mean, if Patrick can keep chaining together Silence the Believers, he could get back in this game. Of course, he can keep Fleeceman Lion back to block Courser of Krufix. I mean, Patrick needs a lot of things to go right here, but he plays four copies of Silence the Believers for explicitly this purpose. When the game goes late, Silence, one of the only cards that can kill multiple creatures consistently in this format.
Yeah, it really takes over in the late stages after the players get up to the requisite. Yeah, seven mana is a pretty nice, nice starting point.
Silent ultimatum at 10, exiling three creatures. Not too bad.
I like that. Silent ultimatum.
Silent ultimatum.
Three creatures.
We've got Gruul ultimatum, that's Revel of the Fallen God. Mm. Silent ultimatum for just a series of lame in-jokes for the players that were around during Shards of Alara.
And finally, I was one of them. I get an in-joke. I'm happy.
Yes.
Okay.
And what's going to happen with that second Sphinx?
Yeah, what's going to happen with the second Sphinx? And I believe that Chapin has also targeted the Courser.
Oh, wow. I didn't see on the bottom of the screen. So Chapin had 10 mana.
Right.
So we can take out the Courser, too. Wow, I thought this was only a Silence of Believers for two. That is huge.
It does kill... kill that and put Jamie Parke on one card in hand. He can't even play it because he needs to leave something up, though. Chapin still has work to do at four. Uh-huh. Now we see why Jamie Parke was quick to block. It's an entire turn that he bought himself blocking with that carry added.
Chapin slow rolling the card. This is going to be a big, big moment. He doesn't actually need another silence. He could have a Hero's Downfall, too, which would allow him to only fall for one of the attack.
What did he draw? Jamie Parke kind of looks at him sideways like, what is it?
But yeah, and we know he drew a land, but Patrick leaning forward, kind of representing strength the way players do when they've drawn something good, attacking and probably saying, yeah.
All right, attack for four. Doing some careful counting here. Again, Chapin at four life.
Brimaz. Mm-hmm.
Plays Brimaz.
Go.
And he's going to say go. But really, is there much... Chapin is tapping his mana here.
Oh, I guess maybe... Yeah, okay.
All right. So he was just putting a little bit of fear in old Jamie Parke there, and I think it worked. Jamie's kind of shaking his head like, geez, man, give me a heart attack here. And a wry smile from Patrick Chapin. Gotcha.
That is a tight game.
Yes. All right, so, Zach, why don't we take a look at the sideboards for these players so we can get an idea of what changes. In our first quarterfinal match, there was a pretty straightforward sideboard situation. Talk to us about Patrick Chapin's sideboard plan against Jamie.
So I think you bring in Thoughtseize and Read the Bones for sure. You're really interested in gaining a decent amount of card advantage and preventing your opponent from doing that as well. Feast of Dreams could kill Courser of Krufix, but not a lot of other very good targets. I think you have bigger priorities. You definitely want Arbor Colossus as a strong out to Prognostic Sphinx. I think you want Boonsader as a way to punch through Courser of Krufix, Sylvan Caryatid. Not so much Bile Blight, Deicide, Glare of Heresy. Definitely not Drown in Sorrow. I'm not 100% sure about Feast of Dreams, but we saw how important Courser was that game. I think you probably bring it in. In terms of cards that aren't that exciting, I don't think Polukranos World Eater is exactly where you want to be. It just kind of bites the dust to a number of removal spells. You can protect it with God's Willing, but you only have one. Brimaz, King of an Arexos, a premier threat, but not a threat that punches through Courser, gets blocked by a lot. I mean, we see what he's siding out right now, so... maybe that could tell us something. I mean, you can't side out too many threats. The card I'm not that into is actually weirdly Sylvan Caryatid.
You're not that into Sylvan Caryatid.
In this matchup, I might be crazy. I probably am crazy.
I know you're crazy. That much we do know, but that doesn't mean you're wrong.
you know, I think you probably need it just to be able to keep pace with your opponent's early planeswalkers and sphinxes. But if the game goes as long as it did, it's just extra mana sources where really all you want to do if you're Chapin is produce threats every turn. The final argument is just for Elspeth signing it out just because you know the bug deck is set up well against Elspeth. So a lot of options, I really don't know. I mean, this is a hard matchup to sideboard for.
Yeah, I want your insight, Zach. You don't need to tell me card for card. I'll let you go play match after match of this particular matchup, and then I know you'll have it down pat.
Play dozens and dozens of games. I think finally you side out Banishing Light. The instant speed removal is good to be able to tap down Prognostic Sphinx, and as we saw with Silence of the Believers, you can still gain card advantage. Banishing Light, though, I think, it's sorcery speed. The rate isn't particularly good. Your only really quality target is Courser of Krufix, which, you know, you'd much rather be able to answer at instant speed with something like Feast of Dreams or just have more threats in the form of Satyr Colossus. Yeah, right. Read the Bones, I think, is probably your best card in a mashup like this.
Just an auto include.
I think so. I mean, you see two copies in the bug deck, basically, because any time that you're just trying to have the last threat, and I think this matchup is about having the last threat on the board, Read the Bones essentially draws you two threats. The only time it doesn't is if you need extra mana, in which case it allows you to keep more hands, and the last thing you want to be doing in this matchup is mulliganing as well. So I think Read the Bones, very, very important.
All right, maybe we can take a look at Jamie Park's sideboard here and see what he's up to. I'm assuming that we have a similar situation where you're trying to board in. Take a look at his board here, Zach. What do you like?
So I know what I don't like in the main deck. I don't like Drown in Sorrow. I think it does essentially nothing. I mean, it cleans up Elspeth tokens and Bremaz tokens, but not really worth a card. I don't really like Unravel the Aether out of the main deck. I mean, like we were saying with Feast of Dreams, it can kill Courser, but that's basically all it can do. I think you definitely want your Thought Seizes. You definitely want Ashiok. Ashiok is big, big game here. Chapin's deck full of relatively inexpensive creatures that can't kill Ashiok the turn they attack. So Ashiok, basically, you know, Fleeceman Lion, Bremaz, even stuff like Pelucranos is going to be able to put those into play while still remaining on the battlefield. So Ashiok, serious, serious threat. Finally, I think you want Dissolve for Elspeth in the top-end threats. The more I think about it, the more I don't think you worry about Feast of Dreams and Unravel for the Courser of Krufix game. I could see maybe bringing in one just because Courser is so important, but I think Thought Seize, Dissipate, Ashiok going to be your most relevant cards here.
Now,
the Psychic Intrusion, I think, also very good in this matchup.
Absolutely. And one thing for Unravel the Aether, Chapin does have some number of Banishing Lights, right?
Right. Chapin has one in the main deck. We were just talking about siding it out. I don't think it's particularly good in this matchup, but if you're able to make that happen, I mean, it's a pretty big game. You know, you can get a surprise ambush of an attacker or something like that.
Yeah, and of course it kills Courser of Krufix as well.
Right.
All right, so players jockeying for position post sideboard here. And it looks like they've already made their decisions and are getting shuffled up. You can take a look at our feature match area here. It looks a little different than the first few days. It's all cleared out. We're down to one table. And we run it this way. We run it all the way through. We already watched our first quarterfinal match. That was Josh Utter-Layton versus Stanislav Sifka. Josh Utter-Layton was able to beat him 2-1. Right now we're on Patrick Chapin versus Jamie Park. After that, though, we're going to have Andrea Mengucci versus Nam Sung Wook and Reed Duke versus Yuki Ichikawa to round out our quarterfinals. Of course, we're going to bring you both semifinal matches later today, followed by the finals, the big dramatic moments at the end of the tournament.
We had a big dramatic deck presentation just then, slamming it on the table, saying, all right, let's get this match underway.
So Patrick Chapin down a game here in the quarters. He is a well-experienced Magic pro, been playing Magic for longer than almost anybody. This is his fifth top eight.
I think it's number five for Patrick. I think it's number three for Jamie.
It is number three for Jamie. Patrick Chapin also in the Pro Tour Hall of Fame. Jamie's not there yet, but with three top eights and playing the way he's playing, you know, he's a when you start getting up to the 4 and 5 top eights range, you really insert yourself into that conversation in a pretty meaningful way.
Yeah, and when you're testing with a team as good as CFB Pantheon, you're equipping yourself to rattle off a string of top eights as well.
The new guy shows up and hits his top eight.
Yeah, the quote-unquote new guy, Jamie
calling Jamie the new guy.
Top eighting Pro Tours before probably at least one member of the team was literally born. Maybe not quite, but certainly close.
Both of these players very composed under the lights and stress. Why don't we head back down now and get play underway for our second game of the second quarterfinal. Jamie Park's going to be on the play here. Chapin's going to be on the play here.
And Chapin keeping a hand. Temple of Silence, Swamp with double green spells. Corsair of Krufix, Boon Seder. So pretty risky keep for Chapin. Chapin needs more lands, and specifically, he needs green lands. But I think he's saying, look, 7 cards just so important in this attrition-based of a matchup that I have got to keep this and try to draw well off the top of my deck.
And plus, what's the worst thing that can happen here? I mean, it's not like Jamie Park's going to come blazing out of the gates and start attacking his life total. This game's going to go a while. You know, if you can guarantee to Chapin, look, we're going at least a turn 10 here. Just, you know, he knows he's going to find the mana he needs.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I mean, Jamie can get out of Kiora early. Jamie can get out of Threat early. But it's not as though Patrick is playing against Sifka and is just going to die before he casts a spell.
Yeah, he can fall meaningfully behind, so that is an issue. But not the same kind of issue you'd face if you were facing an aggressive deck. All right, here's a turn 2 Fleece main line. Speaking of an aggressive deck, I wouldn't call Patrick Chapin's deck aggressive, but it does have these interesting starts where it can go like Fleece Main Lion, Brimaz, Pelucranos or something out of nowhere and just pile on the threats.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, Patrick's late game, very, very powerful, but his early game is relevant enough to force you to do something. And that mana confluence, huge there. What it allows Patrick to do, not only play the second turn Feast Main Lion, but follow it up with a third turn Brimaz.
So Brimaz, King of Oreskos, hits the battlefield, and it's a cat fight here. Sylvan Caryatid, not going to block either of these creatures well.
Did you feel good about yourself when you said catfight?
Jamie Park is going to have to find a removal spell or a blocker to help stem the bleeding here.
Jamie's only white mana sources are those Sylvan Caryatids.
Is this Thoughtseize?
Wow. And Thoughtseize, good in this matchup, important in this matchup, but not really what you want to be casting when you're staring down 6 damage from Brimaz and Fleecemane Lion.
So Park's turn here is to play Swamp and kill Brimaz?
I think it's probably... you're saying play the Swamp and get Brimaz with Heroes Die and Fall. I think that's what you could
correct.
Do. I mean, Park really wants to be able to cast a Sylvan Caryatid here, and I don't know what the play is. I think I see some merit in that. I see some merit in Downfalling right now.
Yeah, letting Brimaz stay on the battlefield is a sketchy proposition, to be sure.
Yeah, I think you're right, Marshall. I think you just do have to get it out there. You don't want to give your opponent a 1-1 for no reason, but missing out on the opportunity to accelerate is not exactly what Jamie wants to be doing either.
No. Jamie knows he's not going to block anyway, so he feels fine tapping the Caryatid, passes the turn back. But, you know, this is where that Fleece Main Line starts to get interesting. In a couple of turns, you know, Jamie's kind of ignoring it for the moment and just taking the beats, but
12, right?
it starts to become a pretty big issue later on. It can start attacking through Jamie's 2 main creatures, which are the Caryatid. It can already do that, and then if you can find a Corsair of Krufix, and it can attack through that too. Speaking of Corsair of Krufix, Patrick Chapin casts one of his own.
Yeah, Patrick's getting exactly the mana he needs, and Corsair, they're really important. Jamie not really able to get it meaningfully off the battlefield, and without the 5th mana from the second save, Caryatid, not able to cast Prognostic Sphinx or Intrusion this turn unless he rips a land.
But he can cast Reaper of the Wilds, which can at least help keep the lion at bay. All right, so here's Reaper of the Wilds for Jamie Park, and no land passes the turn back. Patrick Chapin, on the other hand, has Thoughtseize sitting on top of his library. A very ominous Thoughtseize. He's going to be happy to see that, and wow, followed up immediately by Elspeth, So things looking pretty good for Patrick Chapin here as far as his start. Really nice stuff. And here's Thoughtseize that's going to take a look at Jamie Park's hand.
Now, Patrick could have used a fifth land there to be able to threaten Bestow on Boonsader, allowing him to attack with Fleece Mane Lion and Courser of Crucifix. Jamie doesn't have mana up to give the Gorgon Death Touch. But without that, he's going to have to content himself with playing simply a Thoughtseize. He has another Courser, not the Boonsader. Boonsader got taken with Thoughtseize. So Chapin's still going to be able to deploy another threat to the board this turn.
And another, I mean, Chapin does have the fifth land. It's just, it's a Temple of Silence.
Right.
So it's going to enter the battlefield tapped here. But that's really important because he's creeping upwards towards Elspeth Manning.
Yeah, that's exactly right. He's going to be able to scry again. Drawing Elspeth, so that gives him the option to, or the opportunity to hit the six land off the Courser. And even though Park's deck is designed to be able to handle Elspeth, getting Elspeth out back by this much pressure is a serious problem for Jamie.
Some interesting problems from Chapin's side. He doesn't know what Jamie Park has on top of his library for once. And, you know, right now, Prognostic Sphinx is the best way that Jamie can threaten Elspeth. So if Jamie draws a land, plays Prognostic Sphinx, then Elspeth gets a lot worse. But at the same time, he's also got Psychic Intrusion in his hand. So if Jamie draws a land, plays Psychic Intrusion, takes Elspeth the next turn if Chapin can't cast it, that's also a nightmare here.
Yeah, there's just a lot of math to be done about what's the likelihood that you're going to draw a certain land, what's the likelihood that your land comes to play tapped or untapped. How do you want to sequence this game? I mean, every pick is defensible.
Wow, and Chapin took Sylvan Caryatid out of those, really trying to stifle Jamie Park's mana draw as much as possible here.
Wow.
And he's going to play his Courser of Crucifix number two. He took a damage. He's going to play his land, though.
Wow, and taking Sylvan Caryatid, just a bold statement there by Chapin. I mean, every once, Psychic Intrusion, Prognostic Sphinx, Kiora, huge threats. Chapin just taking a gamble, being able to stifle Jamie on mana. But even if Jamie doesn't draw another land this turn, Kiora gives him another opportunity to land draw. So, I mean, very bold gambit by Patrick that turn.
Now, Jamie Park drew Thoughtseize for his turn here. Yeah, he just wishes he had more mana all across the board here. He has two different five drops that he'd love to cast here. He'd love to be able to go Kiora and cast Thoughtseize, which is possible, but he'd have to hit untapped black mana off the top of his library here. That would also leave his Reaper of the Wilds open to removal.
I just got information on sideboarding, so it turns out that I wasn't completely crazy when I said you could side out Sylvan Caryatid, because Chapin sides out four Caryatid. Also, despite first game siding out three Silence of the Believers, basically saying there's not that many targets. Jamie boarding out Drown and Sorrow, like we talked about, actually boarding out Dissolve, as well as Unravel the Aether for three Thoughtseize, one Psychic Intrusion, which we've seen, and Bile Blight.
Okay. I still think you're crazy, but but you were right. Which I also predicted. Okay, here's Kiora, the crashing wave for Jamie Park. Kiora. What direction are we going with Kiora here? Is he going to try to hit? Or does he have enough blocks to throw the Fleece Mane Lion in the bubble here? This is a really critical juncture. These next two to three turns are really going to dictate where this game ends up. He is going to put the Fleece Mane Lion so that it doesn't take or deal damage.
And you see, it's a tapped land for Chapin. Chapin's sequencing his turns such that if he was able to draw an untapped land, play Elspeth, not only would he not be threatened by Psychic Intrusion, but he could get the Reaper of the Wilds out of the way with Elspeth's second ability and kill Kiora. So Chapin badly needed to hit an untapped land that turn.
Man.
As it stands now, Jamie has another turn to draw a land, Psychic Intrusion away that Elspeth, which could be huge. Kiora surviving this turn right now, even if Chapin decides to throw away one of the Coursers.
Absolutely that was huge.
Huge.
That was massive, Zach, that he didn't hit that. Now it looks like Jamie Park with his alive Kiora. If he draws a land, he can Psychic Intrusion. If he doesn't, he can minus Kiora to draw another card and try to hit that land drop and get that Psychic Intrusion to get Elspeth out of Chapin's hand. Remember, Chapin did hit a land drop. It was tapped, so next turn he's guaranteed to play Elspeth, Sun's Champion. And Jamie Parke has to breathe a sigh of relief. That was huge sequence right there. If there's an untapped land on tap on top, then that makes Psychic Intrusion a lot worse for Jamie Parke.
So we see Patrick monstrousing the lion, meaning that Kiora's ability not going to be able to target it. Reaper of the Wild still able to block it.
Here's a big draw step, Zach. It's a Thoughtseize.
So Jamie going to be able to deal with Elspeth, but not being able to Psychic Intrusion that Elspeth is a big deal. I mean, obviously, Jamie has access to it. Oh, yeah, right. He can choose to activate Kiora for another shot at it.
If he wants to, he can. Right now, he does have nice blocks, though. He's got the Sylvan Caryatid and the Reaper of the Wilds. Both of them can profitably block two of Chapin's creatures.
Marshall, I think you have to go for it.
He's going for it?
Well, maybe he's not. No?
No, he's ticking up. And here's Thoughtseize, though, to take away Elspeth. So the plan here now, of course, for Jamie Parke is that he can use Psychic Intrusion later and just take Elspeth from the graveyard.
That's true, right.
So he has the long game plan. He needs to find mana, but he will eventually. And right now, he's got Patrick Chapin with no cards in hand. Of course, now he has Brimaz, and we're going to see Brimaz hit the battlefield here potentially as well. There's also another land on top of Patrick Chapin's library, and this is going to be an interesting one as we hit the home stretch of this game potentially.
You have three cards?
So
three,
yep. Patrick is capable of taking Kiora down to two counters if he attacks at the cost of one of his Coursers of Kruphix. Also can play that land, see what his scry looks like. He's got Brimaz, which is another great way to threaten Kiora, as well as Jamie's life total.
Does it cost him a Courser here, though? Jamie's kind of priced into blocking the 4-4 Fleece Mane line here, and that would only leave the Sylvan Caryatid to block the Courser, so.
I was thinking you could block Lion with Caryatid, block Courser. Yeah, but that's bad. Jamie's constrained on mana. Yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Marshall.
This is a somewhat awkward situation that doesn't happen very often, but the Thoughtseize is being revealed because of the Courser. It's also the subject of Scry. So Jamie's like, are you still thinking about Scry, or is that just going to stay there? It is just going to stay there. And it.
This one. Which one is plussed? Which one is affected by Kiora? Oh, okay.
Right. Oh, right. That's exactly.
Right, so one of these is in the bubble, and I think, did Chapin forget?
Yeah, I think that, I certainly forgot. That's why we were like, oh, no, he can threaten it. I think Chapin maybe also forgot, probably also forgot, because now this is big. He's basically, either the attack accomplishes nothing, or Jamie can opt to eat one of the coursers. I mean, it's not really a bad attack from Patrick. I mean, he can assume, if he thinks that the creature is just going to bounce off one another regardless, he can assume that Jamie may have forgotten about the bubble like we did, and make a bad block and get some free damage in on Kiora. So, I mean, not really a horrible attack by Patrick regardless.
I mean, I'm not a big fan of this attack. They have to eventually differentiate which one is bubbled and which one isn't when damage comes down. You can't forget that part, right?
So right, sure.
It's, I mean, it's not really going to cost Chapin much here.
I mean, I think it's big game for Jamie to lose that Caryatid, if that's what happens.
Yeah, it just feels like he can't lose mana at this point, and he might just have to accept the fact that, well, look, Chapin tapped all of his creatures. He's not going to get to eat of them and really punish him here, but his Kiora is still going to be on four counters, and he's just going to have to make. No, he is not. He is going to take this opportunity to eat one of the Coursers of Kruphix and chump block with his Sylvan Caryatid, bringing him from four mana down
all part of the plan.
To three.
Well, Chapin's joke's all part of the plan, but I actually think that really worked out fairly well for Chapin. I mean, the redundant courser certainly not as important as the first carryata. Now, obviously, Jamie gets some scry triggers off Reaper, but if he's scrying into lands, that means he's putting relevant spells on the bottom of his deck. At the same time, obviously, Jamie actually has to worry about preserving his life total, and the 2/4 coursers he knows about, Brimaz, actually can threaten some relevant damage. So, I mean, both players' plays making sense depending on their priorities. I think Chapin probably forgot about Kiora's first ability, but that combat didn't go particularly poorly for him.
That was interesting. I'm surprised. I really thought that that Park was just going to make the, okay, my Kiora is still alive and nothing really changes blocks. As it stands, though, he has 2 key 5 drops in his hand and now down to 3 mana from 4 last turn. Brimaz hits a battlefield for Chapin as he passes a turn back. And what is Jamie Park up to here?
Now, Jamie can theoretically play 2 lands and a 5-drop this turn if he activates Kiora's second ability and gets 2 untapped lands. That said, that's not the most likely scenario, and Patrick can attack for 10 points of damage next turn, very conveniently, Jamie, at exactly 10 life.
All part of the plan.
I mean, we see Patrick's taking the Sylvic Caryatid with thoughts he's paying off in a big way right now.
Jamie Park deep in the tank about what to do with Kiora the Crashing Wave. He can minus Kiora to draw a card and enable an additional land drop. He doesn't have a land in his hand, though, so enable a land drop. Chapin, 0 cards in hand, but with Thoughtseize on top of his library. If Jamie wants, he can also plus Kiora, nullifying one of the creatures. Remember, it can still attack. So if he uses that on Brimaz, Brimaz still gets to battle and still gets to make a token if Chapin wants. But he doesn't.
And Chapin now moving far to the left.
This is a pronounced action here from Chapin to remind himself that that courser is in the bubble.
Oh, man.
There is Arbor Colossus on top of the library for Chapin. Remember, he just threw Thoughtseize. Doesn't seem to be any reason at all not to run that out here. Now, one thing that we will note here, though, is that Kiora the Crashing Wave's on 5.
Yeah, and we have seen Kiora's ultimate take over a lot of games over the course of this tournament. Patrick, you know, a lot of tension here. He wants to be able to threaten Jamie's life total, Jamie all the way down to 10. But you have to think, you know, Patrick's threats, very good threats. We see Arbor Colossus, Primaz, Fleece Mane Lion, Courser of Kruphix, but not quite as, not quite able to keep up as a 9/9 Kraken every turn.
Right,
so.
But Chapin's able to actually just kill Kiora here if he wants, assuming that that Park has nothing else.
Yeah. Yeah, Chapin can kill Kiora if he wants.
He absolutely can. He would lose Primaz in the transaction, potentially. Jamie Park can block Brimaz with his Reaper of the Wilds, but that leaves a token and a Fleece Mane Lion to get in to Kiora for 5. Not a terrible exchange for Chapin to take to trade Brimaz. Right.
I must know.
Right. He says, I must know, and he's going to fire off the Thoughtseize and reveal the hand of Thoughtseize, Courser of Kruphix. There's also a Prognostic Sphinx and a Psychic Intrusion that we knew about from before. What did you see, Zach?
I mean, I think that you can actually attack Jamie even with the 1-1. Any combination of Courser, Kruphix, Fleece Mane Lion, and Brimaz is going to be able to kill Kiora.
No, Courser's in the bubble.
Oh, that's right. Duh. I keep forgetting. Right.
Yep.
But yeah, you're absolutely right. Okay, so and he takes Courser. I mean, losing that Caryatid, just big moment for Jamie. I think Jamie thought with that many scries, he's going to be able to see a land. But without Courser, I mean, those 5 drops just not going to come into play.
Everybody attacks Kiora.
Okay, so everything's going to attack Kiora. We described this play a moment ago. And the most likely outcome is that Brimaz gets eaten and Kiora hits the graveyard. Does get 1 scry trigger here. And these are pretty important scry triggers. We've noticed that this type of matchup, These players have not had trouble hitting their land drops in general, since neither are putting particularly rough pressure on each other, though Chapin's draw has been pretty aggressive here. They've just been able to use their scry lands and random scries from Reaper of the Wilds and that kind of thing to find their lands, but Jamie hasn't had a lot of luck with that here. And he still misses his land drop and has to pass the turn back. But that Reaper of the Wild is doing a pretty good job of holding down the fort. And wow, Elspeth again on top of the library for Chapin. He has been revealing some pretty nasty stuff.
I was going to say, does Chapin have three green? But he does, thanks to that mana confluence. We see why Chapin, even though he's a mid-range deck, not a lot of three-color decks in the format playing that many mana confluence. But Chapin playing four, and we see exactly why that's important right here.
So Arbor Colossus hits the battlefield, and finally Chapin has something that can get traded up with that Reaper of the Wilds.
Yeah, Elspeth.
Another missed mana drop here. Now Elspeth is going to come into hand here, but Chapin has decided his line. He's going to play the Arbor Colossus. That means that he's not going to be Elspeth minusing here.
Yeah, he almost jammed it down, but then saying, okay, what exactly am I going to do this turn?
Remember, Jamie Parks all the way down to 10 life here, so Chapin can just bash with a squad. That's exactly what he does. This is going to force Jamie Park to block the Arbor Colossus, give his creature death touch, and trade him off. He's still going to take 7 damage in that transaction, assuming that Jamie doesn't have anything else.
I'll pass priority.
Death touch.
Yep. You take 7.
All right, Jamie Park falls down to 3, and it's looking pretty bad for him. He ships another card to the bottom, and there's Elspeth, Sun's Champion for Patrick Chapin. He is going to make a bunch of near-lethal threats, and with no true sweeper in this format, it's hard to imagine a card that Jamie Park can draw to get him out of this mess, and he never finds that 5th mana source, let alone the 4th after he decided to block with his carry added.
Watching the Kiora on camera, which made me come over in the first place. So it's doing fine for the most part. Just make sure we don't like going to tank for too long. Yeah.
Quick chat there with Lems. He's our judge.
So I'm wondering about if there's going to be any sideboarded changes between games 2 and 3, depending on who's on the play versus who's on the draw. Patrick on the draw might want those caryatids a lot more than he did on the play. Jamie, on the other hand, you know, I'm surprised to see Dissolve sided out, as important as it is against Elspeth, but maybe if players just keep tapping out, there's not enough room to cast it.
All right, let's take a look at Thoughtseize. This is a card that's been around for a while, and it is incredibly powerful. When it was reprinted again in Theros, raised a lot of eyebrows. Everybody assumed you would see it in Constructed for the next couple of years, and so far that it has absolutely lived up to that.
Well, interestingly, Thoughtseize, you know, one of the defining, if not the defining card for Standard, one of the most important cards in Modern, has been comparatively underplayed this weekend. Not all the black decks play it. Of the black decks that play it, not all of them play 4 copies between main deck and sideboard, but very, very, very powerful in any sort of mid-range fight like this, basically allowing you to trade a 1-mana card on the first turn of the game where not a lot is going on for a 4 or 5-mana card that's key later. Also allows you to preemptively answer things like Elspeth without having to do them in response to something like a Hero's Downfall, which allows them to get 3 tokens or allows them to blow up the world. So Thoughtseize is just one of the key cards in any sort of matchup like this. Even do something like take Read the Bones and prevent your opponent from gaining card advantage. I mean, truly just one of the most important cards in this matchup.
Let's take a look at Fleece Mane Lion. That's a card I did not think that we would see a whole lot of here, especially in the hands of a Patrick Chapin. What is that doing in his deck?
Well, and we really have not seen, I mean, I can't think of another deck we've seen that plays Fleece Mane Lion. Patrick playing four copies, but it really makes a lot of sense why this card is so good. As a 2-mana 3-3, it can attack through Sylvan Caryatid. It also blocks almost all of the aggressive cards from the aggressive decks that we've seen, especially like the black and red aggro decks. Then once it's at Monstrosity with Hexproof and Indestructible, cannot be hit by Hero's Downfall, cannot be hit by Silence the Believers, cannot be hit by Banishing Light, and even though it's a 4-4, it's indestructible, so it doesn't get gotten by Elspeth. The final thing it can do is attack for 4 points over Courser of Krufix. So it's a powerful card to begin with as a 2-mana 3-3 with upside, but very, very well positioned in this format. About the only thing that it doesn't attack through is Prognostic Sphinx.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, also a top-down design of the Nemean Lion from Greek mythology, of course, has a hide that you can't pierce. So, yeah, nice flavor win here on top of everything else.
I like that. I didn't know that when it was first done. I'd never heard that, and I had it explained to me via a podcast, actually. Yeah, Graham Stark let me know what was going on with that. There's our feature match area.
You do podcast, Marshall.
I do, but I was listening. I was listening to one, yeah.
Yeah, Hercules having to wrestle the lion and bear hug it to death in order to survive
that
labor.
No spoilers, Zach.
Yeah, I remember during the design phase of the of Theros. I mean, we had resident expert Ethan Fleischer digging through just tome after tome of mythology. So we got all the obvious stuff like Atlas and King Midas and the Nemean Lion, but we also got things like a 100-handed one and the mythical Hecaton Kyrae giants.
Yeah, you guys went deep for sure. A little bit later on today, after our quarterfinal matches are finished, we've got a pretty sweet announcement coming up.
Oh, yeah? What's that announcement?
We're going to have a video of a quick chat with, I believe, with Mark Rosewater, and he's going to be announcing some information about the next fall set, including the name and some of the artwork and stuff.
And that's really exciting. That's actually the last set that I worked on, and I don't know what the name of it is.
Oh, okay. So. I don't either. You know, it's funny. Sometimes these things will slip through the cracks, but this one has not. I have no idea what we're gonna be seeing next fall, and I'm pretty excited. I am definitely going to stop eating lunch to go figure out what's going on with that. I mean, it's just... you know, I tried to get him to show me the video for production reasons ahead of time, but they wouldn't buy it. Yeah, so.
the good old production reasons.
Production reasons. Yeah, clear. That's all I got.
Obviously.
Didn't work.
Hey, Marshall, what are those reasons? Well, I can't tell you.
Yeah, production. No. So, yeah, do stay tuned with us, and we're going to be bringing you that.
I am really keenly interested. We see a buffet of tokens over there on the left side. Patrick probably does not want any Kraken tokens to come into play.
No.
This round, the cat tokens, I think he can deal with. Maybe some soldier tokens, but Kraken tokens spell bad news for Patrick Chapin.
Jamie Park was dangerously close to actually being able to ultimate his Kiora there, but not quite.
Both players and commentators going to make sure to remember which Kiora plus one activations are targeting which creatures. That can spell pretty quick, unintentional end to the game.
Yeah, there's a lot of things to track in these mid-range matchups, too. I mean, there's cards on top of libraries being constantly revealed. There's scry triggers, and then there's these Kiora bubbles and random things that sort of float around that you can't actually see.
Some things like monstrous triggers from things like Arbor Colossus and Pelucranus. Just, a lot of effects. I mean, this is a skill-intensive format. There are a lot of choices to make. As we saw, even amongst the very, very quick aggressive decks, a single wrong decision can cost an entire match.
Okay, I think we're about underway here. This is game 3. Jamie Park able to take down game 1, but Chapin equalizes. Both of these players fighting to get on to the semifinals here. This is our second semifinal match. We're going to be bringing you the other two in order after this, then two semifinals, and then the final. One of these players is going to be in the semis, and it's one game to decide it.
Both players keeping their hands. We saw Pat Chapin really draw out of a kind of risky keep last game, but both players seem to be a lot more solid on their keeps for this one.
Okay, so Jamie Park starts things off with the requisite scry land here. And let's take a look at Park's hand here, Zach. He's got a couple of lands, a bunch of removal, and a read the bones.
Yeah, I mean, I think basically all you want if you're Jamie's deck in this matchup, really either of these decks, is three lands and read the bones. That's going to get you to everything you need and get you that raw card advantage that's so important in this format. Meanwhile, over there, Chapin just a lot of three-mana threats, and again, unlike last time, has all the mana he needs to cast stuff.
Okay, Chapin has his own temple, passes a turn back to Jamie.
We see that early Bile Blight, really the only target for that Fleece Mane Lion, or the only good target for that Fleece Mane Lion. It can't kill anything else.
Yeah, just Soldier Tokens, sweep those away for a turn.
Soldier Tokens, definitely, and it can get the Boon Seder, but both Boon Seder and Elspeth have probably done their damage by the time you're casting Bile Blight. But as we saw, I mean, very important to be able to get that Fleece Mane Lion off the table early.
Now, Bile Blight does have another use, though. It can, you can block, right, and then use it in combat to kill things that maybe you wouldn't otherwise be able to.
For sure. You can definitely block, for example, a Brimaz and shrink it. I mean, it's definitely not a blank card.
But yeah, certainly not as good as something like a Hero's Downfall. So here it is, Read the Bones for Jamie Park, Scry 2. Even the draw cards have Scry attached to them in this block.
I think we probably shouldn't be surprised to see at the Pro Tour on Sunday a lot of Scry happening. Deck manipulation, just historically, one of the most powerful things you can do in a game of Magic. Even something like Scry 1 seems like a minor effect, but I mean, it just controls the entire pace of the game. Being able to select when you're drawing your lands, when you're drawing your spells, and being able to dig into the spells that matter most, we've just seen that define action all throughout this weekend.
Take one.
All right, take one, says Patrick Chapin, but he's looking to bring the beatdowns. Brimaz, King of Orescos, is the first meaningful addition to the board here, and it's a big one. It is going to prompt a removal spell from Jamie Park of some sort.
I have to point out that Brimaz is a literal lion king. I think his name is Mufasa, actually.
I like that.
We see it get eaten by Silence the Believers. I mean, you know, sometimes you want to be able to hit two targets with Silence, but you just can't afford to start getting hit by a Brimaz.
I mean, he had Hero's Downfall he could have used as well, but he wants to save that, I'm assuming, for Elspeth. Also, this way he uses up all of his mana for the turn.
Jeez, you have a lot of removal.
Yeah, we were just thinking that too, Patrick Chapin. Lots of removal in hand. And Chapin's hand looks like, well, he's got a lot of creatures that die to removal, so I think we're going to see a true attrition fight here. Fleece Mane Lion, Boon Seder, another Brimaz, and a Courser of Kruphix, and all of these things are subject to the removal that Jamie Park has.
I'm getting a sideboard update from the field. Jamie changed nothing. Patrick took out his God's Willing. Really good against this spot removal, but not good if you can't stick a threat, which is likely with Thoughtseize and Psychic Intrusion, bringing in an additional Silence the Believers for some of those mid-range cards.
Now, did I see that Jamie Park has a Cure of the Crashing Wave in his hand, too?
Yeah, he does, and I think that's exactly what you're going to take right now if you're Patrick.
You have to, right?
I think so. I mean, that's too much removal to really control, and, you know, you've got Courser of Kruphix, you've got Boon Seder, you've got ways of generating card advantage, so I think what you try to do is just try to play around Jamie's removal in a way that allows you the opportunity to cast two for ones.
Yeah, I mean, I think that Jamie Park has a pretty clear line there. If Chapin doesn't take it, he can just cast Kiora, bubble something, and then kill, 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 ultimate, and then the game ends. So
exactly.
Cure of the Crashing Wave, though, in the graveyard now, thanks to that Thoughtseize. And there is the king. He's back. Brimaz.
And playing Brimaz there, you're pretty sure it's going to die, but it means that Jamie can't cast, you know, an Ashiok next turn, can't cast, you know, any number of... Basically, it gives you initiative. and forces your opponent to play removal or risk starting to take damage. So it's not one of those situations where you can say, oh, my opponent has an answer, I'm just not going to do anything. I mean, it's still important to develop threats to the board.
Yeah, I mean, these removal spells are going to hit these creatures at some point during the course of this game. If Chapin keeps casting threats and offering them up, he's the one who gets to keep playing spells that matter and keep Jamie Parke tapping his mana and able to do things like read the bones or take a turn off to maybe cast a carry at it or something like that. He's going to really keep the pressure on.
Exactly. And he's got Jamie doing all of these things on his main phase because the last thing Jamie wants is for Patrick to untap and draw God's Willing.
All right, Hero's Downfall takes down Brimoz, has a turn back. Now, let's see how the threats keep rolling here for Patrick Chapin. He draws his Swamp for his turn. Jamie Parke just has one mana up, nothing to fear there.
I think you want to play a Courser and try and draw a land off the top of your deck here. I mean, Fleece Mane Lion, I think you want an opening where you can play it and monstrous it through Bile Blight. If you can force your opponent to keep main phasing removal, it's going to be harder and harder to leave Bile Blight up. On the other hand, you know, two black mana is not that hard for Jamie to have access to, so I see just wanting to play multiple spells a turn.
All right. Chapin agrees with you, Zach, and sees another Courser Crucifix on the top, but he's hitting his land drop anyway. Yep. And Chapin's just going to go. He's just going to say go.
Yeah, I can't actually cast Lion even if he wanted to off Mana Confluence and Swamp.
Right.
Another Courser means that he's got even more ways to try and gain card advantage, or at least attempt to, by having a land on top of his
right.
deck.
So here's Thoughtseize from Jamie Parke revealing Hero's Downfall, Fleece Mane Lion, and Boonsader.
The Boonsader's flash ability also relevant, even if it's not going to bestow, just because if Jamie taps low on a given turn, it can come down on the end step and attack for 4 damage before Jamie can react at sorcery speed. His Thoughtseize here, just similarly, just kind of rough for Jamie. I mean, it's good to be able to take any of those threats, but every one of them are potentially very, very important, and Jamie dealing himself 2 damage.
He's going to take the Fleece Mane Lion, the most difficult threat to deal with as the game goes into the later stages. He has answers for Boonsader in his hand, so he's not that worried about it. Remember, a little pretty interesting there. I mean, Chapin knows about the other Silence of the Believers, right?
Right.
And, you know, that makes Boonsader a bit worse as bestowing it becomes just a 2-for-1.
Right, a big land on top of Patrick's deck, a temple, going to allow him to stack with even more threats. Also gives him the 6th mana to make all of his Elspeths live. We haven't seen a single Elspeth get Thought Seized away or Psychic Intrusions away, meaning that Patrick has 4 Elspeths somewhere in his deck. And with Hero's Downfall kind of overloaded, really threatening Jamie, with Courser threatening to draw more and more cards, Park's going to have to play that Hero's Downfall and Silence of the Believers or risk falling very far behind. There it is.
Hey, right on time, Zach. There is Elspeth, Sun's Champion.
And Patrick just having the discipline, not playing any more threats, does not want to walk into a Silence of Believers for 2 cards, and he can play Boonsader at instant speed like we were talking about, either bestowing it upon the Courser of Crucifix or just running it out there by itself.
Yeah, I think running out there by itself seems to be the better option here. Again, that Silence of Believers exiles the creature and any auras on it.
Right.
And Boonsader's an aura at that time if it's bestowed, so Chapin just doesn't, he just can't really risk that.
Yeah, you're not really used to getting 2-for-1 when you're the one using the bestow ability, but that's explicitly what Silence of Believers was printed to do.
I don't know how Raptor's playing this deck with 24 land.
Yeah, we heard Luis talking at the desk about how they optimized and said the deck really didn't want more than 24, but we've seen Jamie stalled on lands with 26. Wow, and then Jamie top decking Psychic Intrusion. Big moment, but Elspeth not in Patrick's hand. It's on the top of the deck.
And six mana looming on the other side of the battlefield from Jamie Parke. He knows that Chapin can draw and play Elspeth. Now, Jamie Parke does have Hero's Downfall in his hand. He has an answer to Elspeth. Of course, the tokens are another story.
Right, and I mean, Jamie taking Hero's Downfall from Patrick basically gives him a straight 2-for-1 if he has enough time to play all those cards. But if he doesn't, you know, Jamie can take up to six damage next turn if he commits his board to something like Psychic Intrusion that doesn't affect the board.
You know, this is one of the benefits for Patrick Chapin's deck in general. This draw, maybe not so much, but being able to pressure your opponent means they don't get to take a turn to play a card like Psychic Intrusion and just take the turn off. You know, this way you actually keep the pressure going.
As the old adage goes, there are no wrong threats, only wrong answers. Sometimes even the right answers don't come quick enough, and that's basically what we're seeing this game. Jamie has the tools, but doesn't necessarily have the time. Interestingly, Patrick not opting to Boon Satyr at the end of the turn. Probably doesn't want to run it just into Bile Blight plus Silence.
Gain a life. 19.
Patrick Chapin gains a life from his Courser, revealing another land here. And we're just going to see Elspeth here, right?
I think we're just going to see Elspeth plus Activation, taking the Hero's Downfall and Bile Blight from Jamie. I mean, but without the instep Boon Satyr, Jamie, not necessarily under that much pressure, has the opportunity to cast a removal spell on Elspeth and Bile Blight the tokens, follow up with Psychic Intrusion. Jamie only following to 12 from this attack, so.
I assume that resolves.
Yep.
So Jamie has a little bit more time now without Boon Satyr on the table, but still not an infinite amount of time. And, you know, Chapin's hand, Courser, Krufix, and Boon Satyr both still there, presenting a lot of problems for Jamie.
Hero's Downfall, Bile Blight.
Yeah.
So 2-for-1. Still for Patrick Chapin, but you know, one of his best threats in his deck is in his graveyard now, so Jamie Parke now can go for Psychic Intrusion, get that Elspeth for himself, potentially.
That takes a lot of time, but I mean, Patrick's deck, although it plays for Elspeth, not actually very well set up to deal with an Elspeth. Certainly not a lot of evasion.
Intruder.
I mean, it plays 4 copies of Hero's Downfall, obviously, but it doesn't have anything like Bile Blight to be able to mop up the tokens.
I didn't even know how I did that.
Take it down. Okay, Hero's Downfall chosen by Jamie Parke. So he's got himself another removal spell sort of in the holster here. Chapin draws the temple, reveals another temple. So kind of churning through his library here, getting land after land off the top.
Down to an island, Silence the Believers from Jamie.
Gain life and scry. Mm-hmm. 20 to 12.
Goodness.
Keep.
Keep, Patrick says.
What did he reveal?
Elspeth.
Okay. That wasn't on our main monitor, so.
Oh, yeah. Elspeth, basically exactly what he's wanting right there.
Take 2.
I mean, I felt like he felt pretty confident when he said keep. Still curious what it was. So there it is. Elspeth, Sun's Champion. Jamie Parke falls down to 10. Now, there is Hero's Downfall. It's not literally in Jamie's hand, but it basically is. So we can run through this through the motions again, but I mean, isn't Elspeth still just awesome to make the 3 tokens and keep the pressure going on Jamie?
I think so. I mean, Patrick, again, didn't play Boonsader earlier, not playing a second Courser of Krufix. Looks like he's really trying to prevent Jamie from getting a two-for-one out of that Silence the Believers. And there's some merit to that. I mean, Courser Krufix gaining card advantage, dealing damage. Patrick basically forcing Jamie to two-for-one himself whenever he casts one of these Elspeths. So Patrick just not really in very much of a hurry.
Maneuvering here.
So he does have the 7 mana for Silence the Believers, but if he does that, he's not going to be able to cast Hero's Downfall this turn. Just chaining temples into scries off the top with that Courser. I mean, Courser, as we've seen so many times, just taking over this game.
His deck has been nice to him here. It's always every single time he hits his land and every single time it's an action spell right underneath it here. And there's 2 more damage to drop Jamie Parke, potentially down to 10, though. It looks like he's done the old pick up the pen, but now I'm going to think about it here. No, he's going to take it.
You're at 8?
Yep. Goes down to 8. Chapin's at 21, and I'm assuming this is Elspeth. There it is. Elspeth, Sun's Champion on the battlefield once again for Patrick Chapin, looking to close out this game 3 and put himself into the semifinals.
This time, Jamie has the Hero's Downfall, but does not have the Bile Blight. Those tokens plus that Courser representing a 2-turn clock for Patrick, and even something like Kiora off the top, not going to really be able to stop all those tokens, plus the remainder of the threats that Patrick's got in his hand.
All right, so this is going to be Silence the Believers on a token, and of course on the Courser. And now he gets to use Hero's Downfall to take down Elspeth, leaving Patrick Chapin in a pretty good spot. Unfortunately for Chapin, he's 1 mana short from being able to play that Boonsader on end step here.
Right.
But he can also just bestow it and get similar effect.
Right. Now that he's drawn the Silence, the Believer's able to use the Boonsader effectively with haste.
You mean drawn it out of his hand?
Right, yeah. Right. Exactly. He's not drawn it like a card.
Got to make sure that Hero's Downfall goes over to Chapin's yard.
Oh, yep, big deal. That would not be a good way to start the semifinals if Chapin ends up advancing.
Reveal the channel fireball sleeve somewhere in his head. All right, there's Brimaz. Jamie Parke as composed as ever, but really up against it here as Chapin tries to solidify his bid for his semifinal seat here at the Pro Tour.
Jamie, representing another Silence of Believers, but I think you have to go for the pressure with Boonsader with these tokens. Such a relevant clock.
Boonsader.
And there's a Boonsader. This would be 6.
I got more gas in the tank, man. I'm trying to draw it out.
and Brimaz, another really powerful follow-up. Again, as we've said over and over throughout this tournament, no Supreme Verdict, no Day of Judgment, no Wrath of God means that you can just commit threats to the table. And if they're not small enough to be eaten by a Drown in Sorrow or Anger of the Gods, you can trust them to stick around.
Yeah, and they're going to, and Chapin is going to win this game. I mean, is there a card that Jamie Parke can draw here to get him out of this? He just sort of pump-faked the mana, but Chapin said, look, I'm trying to draw out your removal. I've got a lot more gas in the tank than this, and he does.
I mean, Silence the Believers from Jamie clears out the Boonsader and the token and the Courser.
But that would
still mean that he would fall to 1 from the attack, and Brimaz still in Chapin's hand. You see him playing the Courser, not the Brimaz, in case Jamie is able to follow up with Silence the Believers. But Jamie basically needs, like, running Silence the Believers into running Prognostic Sphinx to remain in this game.
Okay, so let's see if Jamie Parke can do it. He is facing a massive task here. He's just got 1 draw step, facing lethal from multiple threats from Patrick Chapin. What did he draw?
I think he drew a Courser of Krufix.
He did. All right, Courser of Krufix reveals his second Courser of Krufix, and all that's left now is for Patrick Chapin to attack with all of his creatures. If he does that, he's moving on to the semifinals and knocking Jamie Parke out of the tournament.
Amazingly disciplined play by Patrick. I mean, just understanding that he's going to present threats and go slowly until Parke can figure out a way.
Yeah, it's not going to matter, though, because here's Thoughtseize to clear the way, and Patrick Chapin defeats Jamie Parke 2-1 to secure his seat in the semifinals here at Pro Tour Journey into Knicks. Whew. These matches get intense. They're very grindy. Right? It's card advantage, card advantage, card advantage. But when the dust finally settles, usually one player can pull ahead. And even though, I mean, Chapin was in the driver's seat there, it wasn't quite over yet.
Yeah, no, it wasn't. I mean, cards like Silence of Believers really enabled big comebacks. I mean, like we said, there's no Wrath effect, no Supreme Verdict effect, no way to kill all creatures. But Silence of Believers, if you're willing to pay enough, gets a lot of them. So a back-and-forth game, even with one player in the driver's seat, but a pretty convincing win, all that being said, in Game 3.
Yeah, it really was. Patrick Chapin now moves on. Josh Utter-Layton also has his seat in the semifinals locked up. We've got two more quarterfinal matches to bring you today. Before we make it all the way to the semis, we're going to bring you both of those. And then, of course, the finals will be upon us. We've got some sweet announcements about the fall set coming up today. A couple of fun things lined up as well. We're going to get Patrick Chapin for a quick interview here. You know, Patrick hasn't won the Pro Tour before.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's gotten Hall of Fame. He's, you know, top eight across 3 decades. He has best-selling books out about Magic. What he doesn't have is the title of a Pro Tour champion. So Patrick is hungry for this. Patrick wants it. And his deck, very well positioned in this field. We might see the Innovator take down a Pro Tour today.
All right. Speaking of the Innovator, he is standing with our own Tim Willoughby in the feature match area for a quick interview.
Hello, I'm Tim Willoughby here with Patrick Chapin after a big quarterfinal win there over Jamie Parke. A little bit rough in the first game, though, there. You managed to pull it out, though.
Both games. Rough in the second game, too, but I got incredibly lucky and ended up having some chances to come back into it.
And, of course, this not your first Pro Tour top eight by any stretch of the measure, but you've already referred to this as potentially another step on a bigger journey to try and get to the World Championships.
Ever since I was a kid, my dream's always been to try to win the World Championship. Or not to try, but to win the World Championships. And I came close a few years back, losing in the finals. But the only 24 people get invited, and the way that I win a qualifier slot is winning this tournament. So that's what I'm focused on.
Just two steps left in that journey here at Pro Tour into Knicks. We've got Patrick Chapin. He's going to be playing against Josh Utter-Layton in the next round. Another tricky matchup, kind of similar to that one. Is that sort of one set of testing, or have you had the team doing all the different matchups?
No, it's the decks are very, very similar. Josh's deck is very similar, and because 12 of the people on the Pantheon were on Bug, on the black-blue-green deck, in play testing, whenever I wanted to try a brew, people were always willing to play with Bug. You know, they're always like, hey, can we get some reps in with Bug? So got a lot of games against it, and I played against Raptor. Oh, I didn't actually play against Raptor, but... it'll be interesting because they got a few things a little bit different, and obviously he's a hell of a player.
Thank you very much, Patrick. We'll let you have a little bit of a break now, a little bit of sort of recentering prior to your next match. But we're going back to the booth now. I'm being Tim Willoughby with Patrick Chapin.
Thank you, Wheelbarrow, down there with Patrick Chapin. And we are going to be moving on to our semifinal matches here in the next little bit of time. We're going to be going back over to the news desk in just a moment here for some things. You and I are actually going to be transitioning over there as well, I believe. Why don't we head back over to the news desk for now? When we come back, though, to the booth, we're going to have two more quarterfinal matches followed by the whole rest of matches for the weekend. We'll see you guys in a bit.
All right, thanks very much to Marshall and Zach. They'll be with you at the news desk in a little while. I thought I'd rest my weary bones and sit in the comfy chairs on the far side of the studio. First things first, I know a lot of you are very excited about the announcement for the fall set. Well, we've had two quarterfinals and we have two more to come. In the lunch break after the fourth quarterfinal, we will play you a video in which Mark Rosewater and I sat down a little while ago to talk all about the fall set for 2014. Name, key art, some of the story, some really cool stuff. So that's going to be coming in the lunch break. We're so excited about it. We're going to show it to you twice, so you make sure you get all the key information. So why don't we take a look at the bracket then here at Pro Tour Journey into Next. Our first two quarterfinals are done, and we have Josh Utterleighton advancing to the semifinals. He was our first winner. There you see it. He advanced past Stanislav Sifka, and now Patrick Chapin by 2-1 over Jamie Parke. So we will have Josh Utterleighton with his 5 Pro Tour top eights against Patrick Chapin with his 5 Pro Tour top eights. What a heavyweight semi-final that is in store. Who will be on the bottom half of the bracket? Well, that's what we get to find out next. So we're about 10 minutes away, a little bit more maybe, from our third quarterfinal. I'm delighted to say that I've been joined here in the studio, not by LSV, but by this man, LST, Li Shi Chan of Hong Kong. You can see up on the big wall there, his stats, a gold pro, already 37 points this season, a terrific performer. 2 Pro Tour top eights, returned to Ravnica in 2012. And then, of course, Born of the Gods with the Blue Moon deck, which was fantastic fun. 2 Grand Prix top eights, a title at Grand Prix Birmingham, and twice on the national team. So, Lee, thanks so much for being with us here in the studio. And the first thing I want to ask you is about you. When did you start playing Magic the Gathering?
I start from Opticy. Invasion and Opticy proc.
Mm-hmm. And what were your expectations when you started Magic? Was it just it was raining outside, so you decided you'd play a new game for an afternoon, or?
Yeah, it's just just a card game for me at that time.
Mm-hmm. When did you start to see that there was a bigger world that you could be part of in Magic?
It started from when I was an exchange student in England in 2008, and I go travel around Europe and I play 3P, and I hit the Birmingham GP Birmingham and mm-hmm. win.
Now that was a block constructed GP, if yes. memory serves, and you utterly dominated a top eight that was packed with really great players. Jake Van Loon was around at that time. Raph Levy was in the top eight playing Elementals. What did you play? Were you a white weenie player then?
Yeah, Kifkin.
That's right, the Kifkin from Longwell. Fantastic stuff. Now you are part of one of, I think, the most impressive teams, not precisely because of numbers, but because of just the geography of bringing you all together. Tell us a little bit about Team MTG Mint Card and how you all came together.
Everything started from Guo Zhijing winning the World Champion, the Magic World Cup.
Mm-hmm.
And then start from there, MTG Mint Card approached us, said maybe they want to start doing some sponsor.
Yes,
or, yeah.
Uh-huh.
So, and then he picked the company picked up me and Guo Zhijing, and then we go to Pro Tour, return to Africa, and then I make topic in deck. Then everything start flowing together.
Okay, how difficult is it? Yes, there's internet. Yes, there's email. Yes, there are carrier pigeons, I suppose. How difficult is it, the fact that you are from so many different countries? Tell us where everyone's from.
This time we got members from Taiwan, Singapore, Hong Kong, China, Korea, and last photo is got Japan, Ken Yuko Hiro from Japan.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so we basically just communicate in online and we play test by ourselves. So we get together 1 week before the photo and you try to play test real hard.
Mm-hmm. How much was the balance? We always have Grand Prix just before a Pro Tour. This time it was Warsaw in Europe, Minneapolis here in the United States. Different people took different approaches. You go to a GP to learn the format that you're going to play. People went to Warsaw because of the limited portion. Some people went, I've got a good modern deck. You, of course, are a great modern player. I'll go to Minneapolis. Other people, testing. What was the approach for MTG Mint?
Because we are in Asia, which we don't have many GP for mm-hmm. us, so we have to just try to go to every GP around the Pro Tour. We fly to America, so we just play the GP before and after that.
Right, so we're going to see you again at GP Atlanta next week?
Sure.
At home, if you are in the United States and think you'd like to play this guy and Su Chin Kuo and all these great players from around the world, Atlanta is going to be heaving with amazing Magic players this coming week. I can tell you, the number of drafts that are going to go on in the hotel lobby of the Omni, it's going to be legendary. So you should really get down and join us next weekend at GP Atlanta. But let's get back to the Pro Tour. And you are here in part because you're on the same team as NSW, Nam Sung Wook. Now, that NSW is no coincidence. Tell us the story of how he came to be on the team.
This time we tried to find every player that he has qualified for maybe this Pro Tour and then for Pro Tour in the next year.
Right.
So we gather all the people and we find out Korean actually, Park Jun Yong and Nam Sung Wook is going to qualify most of the Pro Tour in the next year.
Right. Now, Park Jun Yong, you're thinking that's quite a good addition to the team.
Actually, he made a couple top 16 in GP in Asia.
That's right. So, and then I guess to an extent, Nam Sung Wook relatively unknown.
Yes.
We were talking with Chapman Sim out there earlier on, and he was saying, well, you know, if you run good, that's the difference between being top 32 at a GP and maybe winning a GP. So you win GP Melbourne, ah, fantastic, well done you, but it's still kind of, I don't know, maybe he got a little lucky. And then you found out what NSW stood for. It turns out, boys and girls, that on Magic Online, if you look, leading the Player of the Year race in Constructed on Magic Online is NSW, and that is Nam Sung Wook. What was it like when you all found out that he was NSW?
It's like, what?
What? Yeah, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, we just got Asian Reed Duke.
Yes.
Fantastic. Oh, what a result that was. Now, tell us about, you have done two Pro Tour top eights now yourself. That always has to be a help. I've seen the likes of Andrew Cuneo outside and William Jensen talking with Reed Duke and, of course, the Pantheon and Fireball. There's so much experience of Pro Tour Sundays. How important is it to talk to your teammate who's in their first Pro Tour Top 8 to give them the sense of what Sunday is about?
Basically, I never did really well in Day 3. I do make lots of bad play. I know the pressure is really hard. People make bad plays in Day 3. So I have to tell them that you cannot be too relaxed, but you cannot be too nervous.
So it's just to keep even, not too relaxed, not too nervous. So what is his temperament like? Is he someone who is naturally very calm and analytical under pressure? Or in those last few rounds yesterday, when the team is around, it's like, come on, one more, you can do this. Did he feel the pressure yesterday?
I think so. He is 5-3 in day one, so actually it's, one lose is out of contention.
In some ways, though, that can be good because you have the sense of, well, it doesn't matter, I'm not making top eight. 6-3, I'm not making top eight. 8-3, I'm not really making top eight. So it's only when you get to sort of 10-3, you start thinking, hang on, another two or three.
Why not?
Like, why not? Exactly. So he's playing this junk constellation deck. Yes. How did you arrive at that deck?
We playtest a lot against the Moto metagame, which is actually not the metagame we're expecting for the Pro Tour. It's full of mid-range.
Sure.
We playtest against Heroic, Mono Black mid-range, mm-hmm. and we think the Constellation engine is really good against them. So,
okay. Is it a complicated deck to play? Because this is a deck that people are going to start playing on Magic Online. They're going to see, okay, what sort of things should people at home be watching out for when they're playing the deck themselves?
Yeah, casting the cast in the sequence of casting your threat is really, really complicated. And the timing of casting forces, you have to manage which threat to be cast and then which removal or which threat of your opponent to be discarded.
Mm-hmm.
Those are very complicated.
Okay. He's up against Andrea Mengucci, the man who was king of the hill, it seemed, almost throughout the tournament. He's playing red-green with Elspeth. Did you test the matchup a lot last night, or did you already know how it was going to play out, do you think?
We did many playtests last night, and we do think that it's really about the top of the library.
Really?
Scry. Yeah, you flip over the dragon twice, then somehow you cannot manage it. But if you flip Skyland into Skyland, yeah.
Right, so top of the deck is where we should be looking. Listen, thank you so much for being with us. It's great to see a team from Asia that is so spread out and doing so well, because it's lovely to see you guys all around the world. You're always in the shirt. It's fantastic. And congratulations both to you, two Pro Tour Top 8s, and the new man on the block from LST to NSW, coming soon, LSV. I'm going to hand it back to Marshall Sutcliffe, Zach Hill, and Louis Scott Vargas.
Hey guys, welcome back to the desk. Marshall Sutcliffe here, and I've got these two fine gentlemen, Zach Hill, Luis Scott Vargas, to break down our next quarterfinal match for us here. This is going to be an interesting one. Zach, let's take a look at what Andrea Mengucci is playing. He's going to be playing against Nam Sung Wook. I want to know a little bit about Andrea. I want to know about what he's playing too. Let's take a look at Andrea. You get a look at him. A fine looking gentleman, I must say. Nice kid too. I had a chance to interview him a couple of times down in the feature match area. And he was just happy to be there. But look at those lifetime earnings, $1,750. That's going to go up sharply after today.
Yeah, I think without question, his big debut on the Sunday stage. But he's played at four Pro Tours, so he knows how this works. He's played, this isn't his first time at the rodeo. He's playing a deck called Red Green Elspeth, a deck that by far had the highest mainstream win percentage on Magic Online prior to this tournament. He's also playing a version that had a really good read against the field. The most popular deck on day one was a black-green-white deck featuring tons of enchantments. He's main decking 3 copies of Destructive Revelry, 4 copies of Polis Crusher.
And let's take a look at how he got here, Zach, before we go too deep into the deck list. I want to see how his day one and day two went to get to the top 8. I mean, it's a long road, Zach. Things have to go very well for you. Luis, you've top 8ed your fair share of tournaments. Does this look pretty standard for you? 1-1, 1-1, 1-1, 1-1, 1-1, lost on day one?
I mean, you're always really happy when you start 7-1. Mm-hmm. Anytime you can start with 1 or 0 losses. You don't really start thinking about the top 8 till you have, 9-10 wins. And Andrea picked those up pretty quickly. I mean, he started off on a tear.
He did. He 3-0'd both of his draft pods and had a little bit of a shakeup there at the end, round 13 and 14. He lost a couple of rounds, but then moved things forward, won, and then was able to draw in Luis pretty nice. Also, I thought it was kind of cool. We put him on the King of the Hill. He just randomly was on there early. He beat, actually, the first match, because Sean McLaren was the reigning King of the Hill, having won the last Pro Tour. And I think that's why he won all those matches. He just couldn't stand to not be in the feature match area.
Well, I mean, something had to happen. I mean, you see victories over Sean McLaren, Trey Van Cleve, Li Shi-Chen, Andres Prost, Joel Larson, lost to Patrick Chapin, but that is some opposition coming into day one.
Now, he also, if you look on the right-hand column there, he played Nam Sung Wook in round 14. He lost to him, so maybe a little bit of foreshadowing here. Who knows? We'll have to see. Why don't we take a look at the deck list, though? Zach, you mentioned that he's playing, you described it as one of the most popular decks kind of pre-tournament.
Yeah, well, it was a popular deck. It wasn't one of the most popular, but it did have the highest win percentage on Magic Online. Basically, you just play some mana accelerants, you play some monsters, 4 drops, some combination of Xenagos the Reveler, Storm Breath Dragon, Pelucranos, and Polis Crusher. And then after you get done playing these kind of mid-range, big red-green creatures, your opponents use all their removal on that, you have 4 copies of Elspeth, which is basically the single reason you're playing white, for that and a few Banishing Lights. So the idea is, it's basically a classic red-green ramp deck, except that it finishes off with arguably the most powerful card in the format, Elspeth, Sun's Champion.
Okay, now, what are the main cards to look out for in this? And then I've also got a little story about Andrea Mengucci in the feature match area as well from yesterday. What are the key cards? If he starts resolving spell X over the course of the game and you're watching at home, those are the ones that you know that he's in position to win the game.
Well, I alluded to these a bit earlier, but your opponent's playing a deck that has something like 20 enchantments in it. You've got 4 copies of Polis Crusher with protection from enchantments that whenever you activate it, blows up an enchantment.
So that's a big one, Polis Crusher.
I think Polis Crusher is a big one. I think Destructive Revelry is a big one. Again, kills an enchantment, deals damage for the same reason. The other things we're going to have to look out for, though, are the things that we've looked out for the entire tournament, which is the power start of Sylvan Caryatid and Courser of Kruphix. We have seen that the player who's able to control Courser of Kruphix for the most turns just pulls away from the game due to the card advantage.
That's right. Now, I was down there. I was spotter, right? I use the iPad. I'm punching in the cards. I'm calling life totals yesterday, and I saw Andrea Mengucci think about it for a second and decide, you know what? I'm going to ultimate my Xenagos. And this was just nasty. The first two cards he flipped were Arbor Colossus, and that was not the end of the party for him. You get to flip over seven and all the lands and creatures you get to keep, and he got like five out of seven.
Well, let's go right into play.
Yeah, and they go right into play, and he basically locked up the game off of that. So some big fireworks there. Let's move over to his opponent, Nam Sung Wook. He's from South Korea now. I had a chance to watch him play somewhat recently, down in Melbourne, Australia, where he made the trip for the Grand Prix and he won it. That was the standard term. He's playing mono black, but he's now with Team MTG Mint Card. Luis, still young in his career here.
Yeah, I mean, I first heard of him when he won Grand Prix Melbourne, and then he followed it up by making another Grand Prix top eight within weeks.
Yeah, that was in Beijing or somewhere. Yeah, another Asian GP.
The fact that he had two back-to-back, GP top eights pretty much, put him on the radar. I mean, I write the top decks column for Daily MTG, and I featured his decks in the column because he played mono black in both of those tournaments.
Now, still pretty young in his career. He's also on his fourth pro tour, so that's the same thing as Andrea, his opponent. He's a little older in years, maybe some of that experience, nerves come into play down in the feature match area, that kind of thing. But with two GP top eights recently, he does have experience at the high level, and he probably will be able to set a little bit of the nerves aside, though. It's different on the Pro Tour.
Yeah, Pro Tours feel very, very different from Grand Prix, like at pretty much every level.
Right. So why don't we take a look at how he got here. A little bit of a rockier start here for Nam Sung Wook. He 2-1 his first draft pod, not too bad, but then lost the first round of Constructed. Luis, you're sitting there at 2-2 going into round five. I mean, you don't feel great about top-eighting the event at that point.
No, certainly not. Basically, anytime you have two losses early, you don't feel, stupendous. And then, as you can see, he actually lost the last round of day one as well.
Yeah.
So he started at 5-3, and at 5-3, you're kind of thinking, what record do I need to top 25? What record do I need to top 16?
You're starting to scavenge for pro points, but he just ripped off,
seven wins
row, just peeled them off, and then got a draw. Let's take a look at his deck real quick before we throw it back over to the booth. What are we looking at here, Luis? What kind of deck is he running, and what are the key cards?
So the key card is definitely the Eidolon of Blossoms. It looks like they've actually got one of the bug lists up there. Nam Sung Wook is playing black, green, white with Eidolon of Blossoms, kind of powering out just a mid-range card advantage machine. He's got Banishing Light. He's got Courser of Kruphix. He's got Herald of Torment. All these are enchantments. Courser, obviously all these decks are playing anyways. Banishing Light, also just a very good card. And so he's not really paying much by having these enchantments that also double as other cards. And in exchange, he gets to draw a bunch of free cards in the middle of the game. He's got four Brain Maggots that draw a card and steal a card.
All right, well, hopefully that's something that we're going to get to see. The players, though, they are ready in the feature match area. So we're going to throw it to the booth right now for the third of four quarterfinals here from Pro Tour Journey into Knicks.